डियर ऑल, सो इन दिस लेक्चर आई एम डिस्कसिंग द कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ ससेप्टिबिलिटी. लेट्स अंडरस्टैंड द डेफिनेशन ऑफ ससेप्टिबिलिटी. इट इज द फंडामेंटल क्वालिटी ऑफ ऑल द लिविंग ऑर्गेनिजम्स टू रिसीव द स्टिम्युलाई एंड रिएक्ट अकॉर्डिंगली. It is the fundamental attribute of living organisms. The living organism reacts both to internal and external stimuli. So, endogenous and exogenous stimuli. Susceptibility is a reaction of economy, reaction of system, reaction of mind and body. It's a feature of all the living organisms, and entire living kingdom reacts to the external stimuli. So vegetable kingdom as well as animal kingdom all react to the stimuli. So let's understand further why we are studying this susceptibility. So, susceptibility is a quality. It is a quality of all the living organisms. And it's a quality to react to the stimuli, internal as well as external, similarly called as endogenous and exogenous stimuli. Susceptibility plays important role in health, constitution, diathesis, disease, cure, drug proving, remedies, action, posology, and remedy reactions. So let's understand how susceptibility plays important role in all these factors. So susceptibility and health. Susceptibility and health, how they are having the role. So, dynamic functioning of vital energy. So, in health, there is dynamic function of vital energy. Equilibrium between functioning of various organs is maintained. There is harmony between mind, body, and soul. Neuroendocrinal axis maintains homeostasis. So, the neuroendocrinal axis, that is hypothalamico-pituitary target organ axis, maintains the homeostasis. It maintains the most important functions of body. There is regulation of anabolism as well as catabolism. Each cell, the unit of life, which exhibits normal susceptibility and responds to the stimulus. So there are billions of cells in our body, and each cell reacts and to the stimulus. So, the hypothalamico-pituitary target organ axis regulates the various important functions of body to maintain the state of health. And what regulates this axis is nothing but vital energy. So, what is susceptibility and constitution? So, constitution is the collection of endogenous and exogenous factors. So endogenous factors are phenotype and genotype. So phenotype, that is physical characters, are inherited, such as the color of the eyes, the texture of hair, height. And genotype, that is the transmission of hereditary characters. Thus, there is genetic inheritance to the diseases as well as to the various characters like height, like structure of the individual, like color of the skin, etc. So various factors are inherited as well as disease causing tendency is inherited. Exogenous factors are environmental factors and endogenous factors are hereditary factors. So zygote has two different plans of heredity from the parent, and this is determined by susceptibility. Susceptibility and diathesis. Thus, homeopathic remedies are helpful in preventing the development to the disease state from diathesis. So, what is diathesis? It is a stage in between health and disease. Diathesis represents tendencies. So, it is a doctrine of susceptible constitutions, that is tendency. Certain somatotypes are predisposed to certain diseases. So, certain individuals are predisposed to certain diseases. Some temperaments were associated with diseases. So, choleric temperament was associated with the diseases of stomach and gallbladder and liver. So, the hereditary tendencies to cause disease is a preload. So, certain temperaments are associated with certain diseases. Nervous temperament is associated with the tubercular traits. Hereditary tendencies cause diseases. This is the preload the individual is born with. So, diathesis is a stage in between health and disease. Tubercular, hemorrhagic, gouty are various types of diathesis. It's a deviation in susceptibility. So, homeopathic remedies prevent the patient from going from stage of diathesis to disease. It's a deviation in susceptibility. Susceptibility and disease. Organism adapts to his surroundings to maintain harmony so that he leads normal life even in adverse situation. So, this is called as adaptation. So, the individual adapts to the adverse surrounding and he continues to maintain the harmony. This is health. So, in the state of health, there is normal susceptibility. State of good health, nutrition and healthy outlook to life is maintained by normal susceptibility. When the limit ends as a failure of adaptation, which is governed by neuroendocrinal axis for homeostasis. So, when the adaptation fails, the disease starts developing. And in the disease, you will find there is abnormal susceptibility. Development of immunity is due to adaptation. When a person is exposed to pathogens but doesn't suffer. So, even if you are exposed to the pathogens, patient does not develop the disease. This is because of the immunity. And this susceptibility helps in maintaining the immunity by keeping the balance, by keeping the homeostasis, by keeping the regulation of hypothalamico-pituitary target organ axis. Susceptibility and cure. In cure, there is restoration of normal susceptibility. In cure, patient is brought back from diseased state to the normal healthy state. Signs and symptoms are signposted for selection of similimum. So, signs and symptoms are the indicators for selection of similimum. Pattern of process of cure. So, susceptibility is helping the understand pattern of process of cure. There is cleansing up mechanism going on during the cure state. So, cleansing up of the pathology goes on and this progresses within without. Within without means from internal to external. And what is internal is the dynamic deranged vital force. So this deranged vital force starts coming back to normal by administration of internal homeopathic remedy. Thus, vital mechanisms are set to order first. The old skeletons and dirty linen long stored out of sight will be brought out for cleaning prior to final disposition. It means that the old symptoms which were present in the past but were suppressed by the local ointments or by surgery. So these old symptoms called as old skeletons and dirty linen which is long stored out of sight will be brought out for cleaning prior to final disposition. So when old symptoms return back after the administration of homeopathic remedy, so it is the cure which is expected according to Haring's law. So Haring's law of direction of cure, that cure is from above downwards, within outwards, from more important organs to less important organs, and in the reverse order of appearance of symptoms. The old skeletons and dirty linen long stored out of sight will be brought out for cleansing prior to final disposition. So same phrase is again used. Operation of cleansing is return of old symptoms. So return of old symptoms indicate physician is on the right pathway of cure. Drugs, susceptibility and drugs. So drugs peculiarly affect the prover according to the inherent capacity possessed by them. If majority of provers give common symptoms, then let's understand what is the significance. So drug proving is done in homeopathy on healthy human beings. And we require various provers of different ages and both the sexes because susceptibility is different in different provers. It is different in same prover at different times. And the drug also is having different effect on the provers. So if majority of provers give common symptoms, then it indicates general response to the specific capacity of the drug. Example, while proving Allium sepa, majority of provers show coryza and lacrimation, but they are representing common symptoms and they are not important from the point of view of differentiation because they are common symptoms. And drugs do not give all the symptoms in one brewer. They can give few symptoms in one brewer and other remaining few symptoms in different brewers because of the susceptibility of the individual. Thus, if majority of brewers show characteristic symptom, it indicates specific capacity of the drug and represents its identity, important from the point of view of differentiation. Example, burning 3 marks in arsenic oil. Thus, it becomes a characteristic symptom by virtue of intensity. If characteristic symptoms are seen in few brewers, then what is the significance? Brewers experienced for the first time by the brewer indicates highly susceptible brewer, and you should confirm it in reproving. So, brewers who are experiencing for the first time the symptom then indicates highly susceptible brewer, and you should confirm it on reproving. If brewers experience previously indicates peculiar susceptibility of brewers and not the specific capacity of the drug. So, if the symptom is experienced by the brewer previously, this indicates peculiar susceptibility of the brewer to produce such symptom and not the specific capacity of the drug. Characteristic symptoms in isolated instances only. So, in very, very few brewers, if you observe, the characteristic symptoms are seen. This indicates peculiar susceptibility of the individual, called as idiosyncrasy. Susceptibility and remedies. There was aggravation that preceded amelioration. When Dr. Hahnemann started applying law of similars with crude drugs, which shows that maximum susceptibility is exhibited by host to the similimum. Hence, Dr. Hahnemann started reducing the quantity of drug substance. He started diluting the drug substance. This led to the discovery of potentization. So, during potentization, the release of energy, that is the hidden curative power, is nothing but release of energy from drug, and thus in reducing the quantity also. So, potentization serves two purposes. There is reduction in the quantity of the drug substance, and as well as there is release of energy from the drug substance, and this energy is the hidden curative power present in that drug substance. An acute explosive onset of disease indicates robust constitution with high susceptibility and responds best to the remedy administered in high potency. An insidious onset indicates poor susceptibility and responds to deep acting remedies or nozodes. So, acute, sudden, explosive onset of disease. So, it means that suppose a child is playing outside and suddenly he comes within half an hour fever 104. This is called as acute explosive onset, and this indicates the high susceptibility. An insidious onset indicates poor susceptibility and responds to deep acting remedies or nozodes. A well-defined characteristic feature present in the disease, especially at mental sphere, indicates high level of susceptibility and requires high potency. But in advanced stage of disease, when pathological states have taken over, the less characteristic symptoms and more common symptoms indicates poor susceptibility and gives lower potencies and frequent repetitions. So, advanced stage of the disease where the pathology has taken place, you find more common symptoms and less characteristic symptoms indicating poor susceptibility, which responds to the lower potencies and frequent repetition. Sensitive subjects show higher responses like hysteria or overwhelming responses of high grade. This requires medium range of potencies because otherwise the aggravation will take place. So, hypersensitive individuals which are idiosyncratics have high susceptibility, but such cases are given medium range of potencies. Such subjects are serving as good provers, but they are difficult to cure. So, hypersensitive individuals, nothing but idiosyncratics, they act as good provers because on proving they give PQRS symptoms. In advanced cases, characteristic symptoms indicating deep acting remedies like sulfur, silica, kalika signifies extreme susceptibility, but if given in high potency leads to downhill course with violent explosive condition. This is seen in Kane's first observation called as Killer's aggravation. Thus, in pathological cases, if the remedy is given in high potency, the patient runs a downhill course. So here physician should administer a superficial remedy like sanguinaria, pulsatilla, depending on the totality of symptoms. A borderline case, by contrast, weathers the storm and gradually makes a comeback. Patient feels better. So, by judicious use of superficial remedies. This is nothing but Kane's second observation. Prolonged aggravation but slow improvement. Certain conditions where fever and acute exanthemata, example encephalitis, eruptions don't develop and patient goes into the affection of central nervous system. He gets convulsions, then the remedies like zincum, lachesis, sulfur given, which facilitates the development of eruptions. In repertory, these medicines are listed under the rubrics called as reaction poor, where discharges ameliorate. Patient comes with halt in improvement indicates poor susceptibility. Underlying miasm blocks the further response and calls for nosodes and anti-miasmatic remedy. A patient with bizarre symptomatology does not point to any one remedy in homeopathic materia medica indicates morbid susceptibility due to indiscriminate use of homeopathic or non-homeopathic medicines. Nux vomica is useful in such cases. A woman during pregnancy and after delivery is in the best situation to administer the constitutional remedy. An allergic patient with skin allergy have extreme susceptibility. Physicians should avoid use of higher potency and repetitions. The susceptibility to subsequent administration of the same potency tends to fall gradually, which is seen as decreasing responses to the potency as patient shows return of complaints. So change the potency to next higher level. Robert's rule is can change the potency only when response is decreasing. So Robert's rule of repetition is as long as there is amelioration, don't repeat. What is the concept of increased susceptibility? So increased susceptibility gives rise to abnormal responses, such as in hypersensitive individuals, there is abnormal exaggerated response to stimuli like allergy, collagen disorders. Maximum susceptibility of the host to the simulimum is there, so potentization is done. Sudden fever, sudden onset of disease indicates high sensitivity. High intensity of pains indicate high sensitivity and thus high susceptibility. In children and young individuals, there is high susceptibility. Also, in functional pathology, susceptibility is towards higher side. Increased susceptibility determines the response to the administration of drugs. So this is having heightened response. The maximum susceptibility is exhibited by host to the simulimum, late the discovery of potentization and use of minimum dose and infinitesimal dose. Certain constitutions, diathesis, somatotypes also exhibit increased susceptibility. So physicians should be careful in giving the doses to the patients with increased susceptibility. So in the increased susceptibility, he can give higher potency. But higher potency can sometimes brings aggravation. So can use medium potency to start with. Simulimum modifies the susceptibility. So let's understand the response and the role of simulimum. So simulimum modifies the susceptibility and responses to noxious influences. Simulimum promotes better adaptation by satisfying increased susceptibility and lowers it to the normal. If there are progressively deteriorating environmental conditions, simulimum may not be able to protect the patient and adaptation fails. This case will have to be tackled by different therapeutics. Palliation may be required. So this is a concept of increased susceptibility. In this situation, palliative remedies are not long-lasting if disease progresses and if vital organs are involved or there are if frequent relapses. But palliation with homeopathic remedies is always better than the drugs of old school or modern medicines like sedatives and painkillers, etc. Let's understand the concept of decreased susceptibility. So decreased susceptibility, you find poor response of the organism to the simulimum. There is low vitality, more common symptoms, and this is observed in old patients, prolonged lying down conditions. So patients who are in bed for a long time, paralytic patients, or those who are on immunosuppression drugs, or those who are old people, so suffering with the chronic diseases for a long time. So this decreases susceptibility. Physicians should use low potencies and it can give repetitions. So decreased susceptibility is also a abnormal response, that is poor response to the simulimum due to low vitality. This is seen in paralytic people suffering from advanced pathological diseases, chronically ill patients. Presence of common symptoms are found in these patients who are having higher pathological diseases. So in comatose patients also decreased susceptibility as patient is not giving any response. There is history of immunosuppression drugs. So this is a conditions where decreased susceptibility is present. So this was a discussion about the susceptibility, and I have tried to correlate with the patients you will be seeing clinically. Thank you.